Things of God, who has reconciled us to himself by Jesus Christ and has given us the ministry of reconciliation. So then, number one, the model for peacemakers, the Lord Jesus Christ. Anytime you see conflict anywhere, disagreement anywhere, disunity anywhere, discord anywhere, and misunderstanding anywhere, you ask yourself, what will Christ do? Because Christ is a model, and he is a peacemaker. Will he rejoice because he has contention? Will he make the enemies to become avowed enemies of one another? Or will he try to bring them together and bring love in their midst? Then what Jesus will do is what he will do. And now we're introduced to another thing, number two, the ministry of peacemaking. The ministry of peacemaking. Right in that verse I read to you, it says in that verse 18, he has given us the ministry of reconciliation. That means then, reconciliation is a ministry by itself. Peacemaking is a ministry by itself. The ministry of peacemaking. Ephesians chapter 2. I'm reading from verse 15. Ephesians chapter 2. Reading from verse 15. Having abolished in his flesh the enmity, even the law of commandments contained in ordinances, for to make in himself of twain one new man, so making peace, peacemakers making peace. And so, you see the ministry, and this is what the Lord Jesus Christ himself, this is what he carried out, and that he might reconcile both unto God in one body by the cross, having slain the enmity thereby. What do we do in the ministry of reconciliation? In the ministry of peacemaking, we're removing the enmity between those two people. When we're witnessing, when we're preaching the gospel, when we're winning souls to the Lord, what are we doing? We're removing the enmity between that sinner and the Almighty God. It's enmity against God. It's hatred towards the commandment of God. That's what we're removing. And we're doing everything we can that the enmity between man and God, we're removing it. That's what we call soul winning. But it's a ministry of peacemaking. It's a ministry of reconciliation. And when husband and wife, when they have offended one another, and then they have allowed that offense to get in between them, and it drives a wedge in between them, and they say, please pack your load and go. I don't want to see you anymore. If I don't marry in my life, I know I'm not married, get away from here. You know, that's enmity. And that wedge that is in between them, and you have a ministry of reconciliation. What's that ministry? You want to go there and you want to do everything you can do in that ministry of peacemaking to remove the enmity in between them. Two brothers are walking together and they love one another. They put their capitals together. They are trading together. Or they do whatever together. And then something happened among them. Something always happens because there's a devil in the world. And one of them said, now we cannot work together again. And while they are arranging that, one of the other fellow became cunning, clever, crafty. And then he went to take all the money, maybe from their account. And now he says, okay, we're separating now. Are we going to separate like that? How about the money? Am I going to go empty-handed and go anywhere you want? And now what do we do? We want to remove the enmity in between them, reconcile them. Bring them together. That is the ministry. And blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. Number three, the message of peacemakers. The message of peacemakers. Now, if you are to be a peacemaker, see that two people are having disagreement. Two people are fighting. Two people are having discord. Two people are having contention. Two people are throwing stones at one another. Let's say you want to be a peacemaker, and then you just go there looking at their faces, folding your hands, not saying anything. No, you have to say something, because if you're going to reconcile them, it's the word you say that will suit their attention and suit their nerves, that will make them to turn their faces one towards the other. You'll have a message. You'll have something to say. The peacemaker has a message. Number three, then, the message of peacemakers. And we're looking at Genesis chapter 13, verse 8. Genesis chapter 13. And I'm reading to you from verse 8. And Abraham said unto Lot, let there be no strife, I pray thee, between me and thee, and between the herdmen and my herdmen, and thy herdmen, for we be brethren. That's the message. You are telling them, are we not of the same blood, the blood of Jesus Christ? Have we not been reconciled unto God? Don't we believe the Bible? Isn't Jesus Christ our Savior, the Prince of Peace? Should we continue like this? What message are we giving to the world? We are brethren. And because we are brethren, there should be no strife. There should be no contention. Because we are related to God, you are related to God, I am related to God. How can two people have been the same Father? How can two people have been the same Savior? How can two people go into the same heaven? How can two people believe in the same doctrine? How can two people believe in that we need God and these are the commandments of God? How can those two people be so much against one another and we cannot even talk together at all? You have a message. It must be a convincing message. It must be a convicting message that you are telling them. And as you tell them, by the grace of God, with prayer, I believe that they are going to be reconciled together in Jesus' name. In 1 Corinthians chapter 6, the message of peacemakers. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, I'm reading to you from verse 1. In 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 1, here is the message the Lord has for those people that have so much against one another. And they feel that the only thing they can do is to continue that hatred and to be torn apart. Dare any of you, having a matter against another, go to law before the unjust and not before the saints? You have a matter against one another. The peacemakers are not in the world. Because those peacemakers, if you're a peacemaker, you're a child of God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. Therefore, where do we find the children of God? In the house of God, in the temple of God, in the family of God. If those people are there, if they were true peacemakers, they'll be here. Because the peacemakers are children of God. Anyone who is not a child of God cannot be a real peacemaker. And therefore he says, dare any of you, having something against another, you'll go to the people, the unjust, who are not children of God, and not before the saints, the children of God. Do ye not know that the saints shall judge the world? And if the world shall be judged by you, are ye unworthy to judge the smallest matters? Know ye not that we shall judge angels? How much more things that pertain to this life? If then ye have judgments of things pertaining to this life, set them to judge, set them to counsel, set them to mediate. Who are the least esteemed in the church? I speak to your shame. Is it so that there is not a wise man among you? No, not one that shall be able to judge between his brethren. But brother goes to law, goes to the court, it was brother, and that before the unbelievers. Now therefore there is certainly a fault among you, because ye go to law one against one with the other, with another. Why do ye not rather take wrong? Why do ye not rather suffer yourselves to be defrauded? That's the message of the peacemaker. That even if you have to be cheated, you have to take it. Because you want to do this to prove that you're a real child of God. Number four, mediation by peacemakers. Mediation by peacemakers. You know, and when we say we're making peace, you are mediating. You are coming in between two people. And with one hand, you hold the hand of one. With the other hand, you hold the hand of the other. And then you pull those two hands together to reconcile them. We are mediating. And if we're going to be peacemakers, actually, that is the motive. The motive of peacemaking. What's the motive? The motive is to mediate. Is to come in between two people, reconcile them together. In 1 Samuel chapter 19. 1 Samuel chapter 19. I'm reading from verse 1. In verse 1, and Saul spake to Jonathan, his son, and to all his servants, that they should kill David. Here we find Saul on the one hand, David on the other hand. And Saul wanted to kill David. Obviously, there's conflict here. Obviously, there was hatred. And Jonathan saw that. And Jonathan now was going to be a peacemaker. What was he going to do? As a peacemaker, he will mediate. He will come in between them. He will talk to one about the other. He'll talk to the other about this other one and see how to bring them together. Look at verse 4. And Jonathan spake good of David unto Saul. Jonathan spoke good of David unto Saul, his father, and said unto him, let not the king sin against his servant, against David. And you will see the language of the peacemaker is chosen carefully. The language of the peacemaker is selected in a very careful way. And you know the words you're going to say to this one about the other fellow. And you're not talking about things that are irrelevant and things that are not necessary and things that will not contribute to softening the mind of the person you are talking to. Jonathan was talking to his father and said, he spoke good of David unto Saul his father. And said unto him, let not the king sin against a servant. He didn't say against my friend, because Saul was not interested in the fact that David was his friend. All he wanted to know is, how useful is this David? What's he doing for me after all? And what can I benefit from him? And so he said, against his servant David. And then he said, because he has not sinned against thee, and because his words have been toward thee very good. For he put his life in his hand, and he slew the Philistine. And the Lord wrought a great salvation for all Israel. Thou sawest it, and didst rejoice. Wherefore then wilt thou sin against innocent blood to slay David without a cause? And Saul hearkened unto the voice of Jonathan. And Saul sware, as the Lord liveth, he shall not be slain. Do you see this? To rescue one life, and to preserve the life, and to remove the enmity, and to change the mind of Saul, and to change the mind of this fellow that wanted to kill the other. And Jonathan called David, and Jonathan showed him all those things. You are speaking to both sides. You are showing the truth to both sides. And Jonathan brought David to Saul, and he was in his presence as in times past. That's reconciliation. That's peacemaking. That's mediation. Mediating between two people. Number five, the mind of peacemakers. The mind. What kind of mind does a peacemaker have? The mind of peacemakers. In Philippians chapter 4. Philippians chapter 4. I'm reading from verse 7. Philippians chapter 4 verse 7. And the peace of God, which passeth all understanding, shall keep your hearts and minds through Jesus Christ. And you realize that if you yourself, you don't have peace in your own mind. You have your own conflict. You have your own trouble. And let's say, for example, somebody sees a family, the husband and the wife, they're about to divorce. And they're fighting, beating one another, biting one another. And they want to scatter the family, share the children. You go with the boys, I go with the girls. And then this other fellow looks at that family. He wants to mediate. He wants to bring them together. He wants to be a peacemaker. Meanwhile, in his own family, he's not having a peaceful relationship with his own wife. And he's not at peace with his own children. And his mind also is scattered, and you know, they don't sleep all through the night. He himself has sleepless nights because of worry, anxiety, that his wife is soon going to pack out. How can he, since he doesn't have peace in his own mind, how can he go and settle another person's family? Or let's say, for example, that you know, here you have a church location, and the pastor is having problem with members of his own church. And it's like, you know, the members are throwing stones and, you know, we're not going to pay tithes and offering. We're fed up with this. We're going to vote out that pastor. We don't want him as pastor again. Enough is enough. And then he hears that, you know, there's another church downtown there. They too, they are having the same, you know, katakata among them. And the same palaver. And he says, okay, I'm going to be a peacemaker. Meanwhile, the other church downtown, they are hearing a story about his own church, that he too is having problem. And then he goes and says, how are you there? They say, how are you there too? I hear that you have problems. Oh, they say, yes, the same kind of problem that you have. You know, he will not be able to make peace in that church. If you're going to be a peacemaker in your own mind, you must have peace also. in your own heart. You must have peace also. The peace of God must settle in your own heart. That's why it says here that the peace of God, which passeth all understanding, shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Verse 8, finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, and whatsoever things of good report, if there be any virtue, if there be any praise, think on these things, those things which ye have both learned and received and heard and seen in me, do. And the God of peace shall be with you. You have to be at peace yourself in your family before you can go and reconcile families that are having problems. You have to be at peace with your own friends before you can go to make peace with the friends who are having disagreements together. You have to be at peace in yourself, in your house, in every way, before you can be an agent of peace to other people. Number six, the method of peacemakers. The method of peacemakers. As you come to, you know, make peace, and then you say you need to reach some conclusions. And what conclusion are you making? We're looking at Genesis chapter 31. Genesis chapter 31. I'm reading from verse 36. Genesis chapter 31. Reading from verse 36. And Jacob was wroth, and chode with Laban. And Jacob answered and said to Laban, what is my trespass? What is my sin that thou hast so hotly pursued after me? You know, there was a problem there. Because Laban and Jacob, they had some disagreement. And you see the way Jacob spoke. And then eventually you look at verse 43. In verse 43, and Laban answered and said unto Jacob, these daughters are my daughters. And these children are my children. And these cattle are my cattle. And all that thou seest is mine. And what can I do this day unto these my daughters and unto their children which they have born? And then in verse 44, now therefore, come thou, let us make a covenant, I and thou, and let it be for a witness between me and thee. You know, you cannot fight all your life. Life is short. You need to enjoy your life, enjoy relationships, enjoy friendship, enjoy, you know, what God has provided for you. But if from morning till night, and from day to day, and week to week, and month to month, and year after year, it's just conflict and fighting and all that. And you're fighting the day, and by the way, when you're fighting the day like that, when you sleep, you'll be fighting in your dream. And then you'll be sweating, because you'll be running up, they're chasing me, because, you know, you are chasing them in the afternoon, and day two, they are chasing you in the night. And when you are like that in the day and in the night, you'll have hypertension. You'll not be able to live long. You'll not have peace of mind. You'll not have long life. A time then comes in your life when you say, enough is enough. There's going to be peace. And if there's going to be peace, what's the message? What's the conclusion? And what are you eventually saying? Let's look at verse 52. This heap be witness, and this pillar be witness, that I will not pass over this heap to thee, and that thou shalt not pass over this heap, that means unto me, and this pillar unto me for harm. Eventually they came together. They say, let's raise up a method. And the method is this. Let's have something visible, something tangible. And we put it here. And this is a witness that now we have resolved our conflict. We have ended all the war, all the battle, all the fighting. Every time we come over here and we see this sign, and we see this pillar, and we see this heap, well, remember the covenant we have made together. We have made peace. Will resolve everything. I will not pass over this place to come and harm you. You will not pass over this place to come and harm me. That is the bottom line, the summary of peacemaking. That you make up your mind. He makes up his mind. You'll not cross fire, and you'll not cross any boundary to harm one another. Number one, the model of peacemakers. For peacemakers. Number two, the ministry of peacemaking. Number three, the message of peacemakers. Number four, the mediation, which is the motive by peacemakers. Number five, the mind of peacemakers. Number six, the method of peacemakers. Number seven, mistakes in peacemaking. Mistakes in peacemaking. Peace is wonderful. Peace is good if both of us are sincere, if both of us are truthful. Peace is a wonderful thing if both of us mean exactly what we're saying. But you know that there are people that are not sincere. In fact, you'll find the epitome or the climax of that in the personality of the Antichrist in Daniel chapter 8. Daniel chapter 8, I'm reading from verse 25. Daniel chapter 8, verse 25. And through his policy,